Hello, Cheapskaters. I'm Kath Armstrong, creator of the Cheapskates Club, where our goal is to live life debt-free, cashed up, and laughing. It is Tuesday, the 20th of June, 2023, and if this is your first time visiting our channel, welcome. And for my regular viewers, welcome back. Live chat is on. Delaney is our moderator, so please be kind and make her job easy. Now, to join live chat, you need to be logged into your YouTube channel or your Gmail account. If you don't have one, it's not a problem. There's no need to panic. You can leave your comment in the comment section below me after the show. Now, what a week it has been, guys. I am exhausted. I feel like I am, I'm just like, whoa. So tired. All right. So who's joined us? We'll give everyone a few minutes to catch up. Barb might have an early night. Sounds like a plan, Barb. Enjoy. Hello, Karen and Jess and Gloria. Hello, Beverly. Hello, Estelle. I'm glad you think it's a nice topic. Hello, Michelle and Mrs. Dilligaff, Greg Evans, Yvonne. Hello, Delaney. I'm really glad you're here tonight. Simply Good Life. Life is busy. Yes, it is. Aradia, Leone, Paula, Julia, Tegan, Sandra, Sylvia. Yeah, 5.14, it was 5,142 when I checked before. It fluctuates a bit. So it was a bit exciting. Outback 6, Helen. It is very chilly. I just looked before and it's 5 degrees at the moment. Hi, Yvonne. 5 degrees at the moment. So we've got the fire going. Wayne filled it up with logs before he went out for me. And I have my trusty hot cup of tea. Keep my hands warm. But it has been freezing. Hello, Utah. Glad you could join us. Well, it's been a really busy week. I feel like I've gone flat chat for days on end. I had one day off, Saturday. I went and met with some friends. We had a really nice day and did a lot of talking and laughing and solved problems of the world, as we do when we get together, which was really nice. So, but then Sunday went non-stop. Yesterday went non-stop. Today I've barely sat down, I think, today. So I am well and truly ready for bed. It is freezing in Melbourne too. Greg Evans says freezing in Adelaide. Absolutely freezing in Melbourne too. It is going to be a frosty night. I zipped out about 4:30 and put the covers over my garden just in case there's a frost. Because I don't want to lose the silver beet or the cabbages or the cauliflower. I just don't want to lose anything. The potatoes are looking really good. Don't want to lose anything. So I just went out and put covers over them. It's just as easy. Soup sounds good. It's only going to be 12 here tomorrow, Estelle. So soup sounds good. Perfect day for it. Okay, now let me see my notes, because we're going to talk about grocery budget blowouts and knowing what causes them, because we all have them. We all have them. Doesn't matter how strict we are, every now and then we will have a grocery budget blowout. So knowing what they are helps us to stick to our grocery budget, and that is absolutely essential at the moment. I'll give you some facts and figures in a second. We get started. I've got a bit to get through, so I'm really hoping that we will be able to finish on time. I don't want to keep you too late, but I've got a lot to get through. We'll talk about this, and I've got a few other things to share with you. We'll talk about knowing our grocery budget blowouts first. Because look, when it comes to controlling our money, the one area we have complete and utter total control over is the grocery budget. But that control is getting really, really hard. When I was digging around for this show, I found some reports. Now, back in March of this year, there was a report that said 43% of Australian households say the cost of groceries are their biggest cause of financial stress. 43% said the cost of groceries. That's actually ahead of the people who said mortgage interest rates and mortgage repayments were causing them stress. Interesting, isn't it, that we're finding it harder to buy food and pay for food and groceries than to deal with mortgage interest rate rises that have bumped up mortgage repayments by thousands. It's more stressful now to feed the family than it is to pay the mortgage. Now, if you're like me and not a very good cook, it's always stressful to feed the family. It's hard to find things they like. But how is it that for 43% of Australian families, they struggle to buy food? Now, I was listening to a report on ABC Radio this morning. Salvation Army has noticed a 60% increase in the number of people asking for help with groceries, with food. 60% increase this winter, and we're only 20 days into it. That's a lot. That's a lot. I know I keep an eye on some of the food banks and different things, different charities around, not so much my local area, but around the state, and they're all of them have seen huge increases in people needing help just for groceries, just for food, so they can give their children breakfast and dinner. It's a lot. Now, if you don't believe me, that's fine. You don't have to. Do your own research. Go and do your own research. We should all be doing our own research anyway. Don't take my word for it. Don't take anyone else's word. Do your own research and find out for yourself what is happening in our cities, our state, our country, then the world. We need to know these things, because if we don't know them, we can't be prepared and we can't prepare. Now, if you're interested, the next cause of stress under food and mortgage, petrol, and then energy. So petrol was above energy. I would expect that. I thought that would have been, you know, maybe flipped, but I guess we haven't had our winter energy bills yet. The price increases are just starting to come in now, so the next couple of bills will show us just how much more we are paying for using less energy. So I want to know, how are you managing your grocery budget? Australian families, just the average Australian family, can look forward to paying an extra $1,900 on food this year. Just on food. Nothing else, $1,900 just on food. Now, I haven't increased our budget. I'm hoping I won't need to before the end of the year. This is when yearly shopping really pays off. But I'm really hoping I won't need to then either. Because that's an extra $36 a week for food. We can't afford that. I'm pretty sure most families are in the same boat. That's on the average. Some are more, much, much more. If you've got a larger family or you have allergies, food sensitivities, you'll be paying more. Now, to put it in perspective, if you're following the $300 a month food challenge, that's a 50% a week increase in the grocery budget that you need to find. 50%. That's a flipping lot of money that we have to find. The figures were, I think, $185 a week is now the average Australians are spending on groceries. That's a lot of money. Let me just flop back here. And check. Just trying to keep up with the comments as we go through. We've got 73 people watching. Woohoo! 12 in Brisbane. Woohoo! One in the Hunter Valley. Yeah, it's always cold. Always cold. Miserable in the Hunter in winter. Just disgusting. I can imagine food banks had one I sort of follow on Facebook just to keep up. So it sounds like morbid curiosity, doesn't it? But I can't talk to you about these things if I don't know about them. And they are turning people away every day because they just run out. So I imagine, and Boronia is considered quite a low income area too. Beverly says she heard on late night radio a couple of weeks ago, the British PM has told companies to scrap use by dates as Brits are wasting food unnecessarily. Does he know something? We don't know. I would say, look, we have some Brits join us when they can, and we do have British Cheapskates Club members. They are doing it tough. We think we're doing it tough compared to the rest of the world. We're actually sort of, you know, we're doing okay. But for us, it's hard. I have to say, though, use-by dates are fairly new. They came in when I was a teenager, so 35, 40 years ago, maybe, I don't know, somewhere in there. And before then, it was, you know, if it wasn't moldy or it hadn't, you know, shriveled up or whatever, it didn't smell bad, didn't taste bad, it wasn't furry, we ate it. We just ate it. The only thing I remember Mum always saying, if we had cans, if it was rusty, she wouldn't use it. And if it was blown, so if it had bulged, she wouldn't use it. Otherwise, and quite often, if the bread was moldy, it was only the first slice, it got tossed and the rest of it was toasted and we ate it. So use by dates and best before dates are a reasonably new thing. And the skeptic in me, is inclined to think that they are a deliberate ploy to get us to waste more so that we buy more. It's a marketing thing, I think. But anyway, if anyone, does anyone want to listen to Alaska Prepper and Economic Ninja? Was it Economic Ninja or I was listening to it today, and I'm sure it was AP today, was talking about global food shortages and thing. Now, I read a thing last week from the WEF, the World Economic Forum, about how did he word it? I'll try and put a link to it. It was really interesting, and it was pretty much saying we're all going to starve. The other thing that was interesting today was I've been doing some research for some more preparer type shows, and I've been looking into what to do in the case of various disasters. And one of them was an EMP, an electromagnetic pulse. An EMP or a one from the sun, CME, which is slightly different from a solar flare. But anyway, EMPs are generally man-made. CMEs come from the sun, pretty much as a rule. And it was really interesting because there was research done a couple of years ago, and if there was an EMP, a huge one, that took out North America, they did different scenarios, and there's one that could take out the whole of North America within 12 months. 90% of the population would be dead because there'd be no fresh water. There would obviously be no power. There'd be no fresh water. There'd be no medicines. There'd be no hospitals. So there'd be no surgeries, no ventilators to keep people alive, no autoclaves to sterilize stuff, no factories to produce food. 90% of the population would be dead. It's really interesting. So I think that the globalists, they might think that they, I don't know, do they honestly believe people are that stupid? Are people that stupid to believe them? I think that they are setting us up for a bit like, if we say it often enough, when it happens, they'll go, oh, well, that's not so much. We knew that was coming. When really, it's a disaster. I'm talking about kettle chips further down in my thing. Hello, Melissa. -3 tomorrow morning, frost. I can remember being when we were in Wagga, the last winter we were in Wagga, we went for 30 days with -5, -6, or -7 in a row, 30 days in a row. It was bitter. They were the mornings I had to get up and drive Wayne out to work. Oh, it's horrible. Catherine, I think use-by dates on fresh fruit and veg at the supermarket are absurd too, simply because it's not fresh. It's not fresh. A lot of it has already been in cold storage for a certain length of time. It's just ridiculous. Estelle, most of our food goes overseas. We don't keep it here. We have a fair whack of food production, but not nearly as much as we used to, and most of it goes overseas. Most of it's exported, and a lot of it is foreign owned now, not necessarily Australian owned. So a lot of the co-ops are foreign owned, and that has a big impact on how we do here at home. I have my theory about that, but you know, I can't say it because it's too political. I'm going to say it anyway. What the heck? Joy told me the other day to not worry. And, I'm not going to. I think that it's time for our government to step in and say enough. We need to build our food supplies, build our food stockpile before we export. And I know that exports bring in income, but so do Australians. You know, I shop, you shop, everybody shops, everybody eats food, everybody drives cars, everybody uses public transport, everybody wears clothes. If we looked after ourselves, a bit like I was talking about last week, look after yourself first, then you can look after the rest of the world. If we don't look after ourselves, before too long, we won't even be able to look after the rest of the world. Lots of families are really struggling. I haven't heard about that in Australia, Beverly, but I will make a note to follow up with that because that's interesting. Because one of the big things with the price of meat a few years ago was, remember we had that awful drought in northern half of Australia, that terrible drought was just went for years and years and years, and the stations were culling their herds because they couldn't feed them, they couldn't water them, they couldn't afford to buy the feed and water in, culling their herds. And it got to the point where they were actually culling breeding stock, which means that when the drought broke, there wasn't enough breeding stock to actually rebuild the herds. And that's another reason our meat prices have kept up and up and up. Yeah. Use buy and best before marketing ploys. Greg Evans watches AP. Good. I don't all the time, but every now and then I'll pop on to see what's going on. It's very interesting. Alaska is on my bucket list of places to go. If I had to go overseas, I'd go to Alaska. That would be my place of choice. Tegan says she's got some non-pull top coconut cream. Open it. It should be fine. Ring pulls will last about the same amount of time. The issue with the ring pulls is they are more inclined to give before if something goes wrong. They are more inclined to leak, burst, blow, whatever. So they're usually two and a half, 3 years, depending, is about what they say for ring pulls, but you can keep them much longer if they're kept in optimum conditions. Open your coconut cream and see. You'll know if it's off. Eggs marked down limit for Coles and Chris Canada because the use by data pass machine just wouldn't accept the code. That's just ridiculous, isn't it? Okay. Right. Okay. Oh, sorry, I should I think foreign ownership of any I was gonna say sovereign anything that we need. Yeah. Beverly says we all need to buy Australian if we can. Yes, we do. It's getting harder and harder to buy Australian. And with that, you are better to buy, this is going to sound weird, but Australian owned is better than Australian made in terms of Australian owned. They are paying taxes here, they are putting money in, more money back into our economy. Australian made, well, you know, you could have a foreign company making something here, but the profits go overseas. Where the profit, when it's Australian owned, the profit stays here and their taxes stay here, they still employ Australians, so it's a little different, but something we should all look at. And for most things, and I know people get very emotional about this, but there's a lot of things, if you are used to buying generics, if you just buy ingredients and buy generic ingredients, quite a lot of them are Australian. You don't need to worry about overseas. Night, Barb. Thank you, Estelle. Yes, I have a friend in the Netherlands who sort of keeps me up to date a bit. We've had a hard time with chicken in Australia the last probably 4 years. We had the bird flu, then there was something else. Then we got another round of a different strain of the avian flu. There's all sorts of things going on now. with it. Yeah, a lot of our produce, a lot of our meat, a lot of our dairy, most of our dairy goes overseas. We pay a premium for it, for the little bit that is left, and often they are probably not quite as good a quality. We get a lesser grade, perhaps, than what goes overseas for export. Ooh, herrings will be awful. Use the contact us form, and that way I will be sure to get it. Okay. Oh, I'm just catching up. I'm repeating everybody here. How am I keeping warm? I've got my trusty scarf on. I've got about 5 layers on. The fire is going and it's blowing straight on me, so it's really quite nice. Once we light the fire, we don't generally, Wayne lets it go out probably twice over winter so that he can clean the firebox out and whatever. But otherwise, it just goes 24/7. And it is so nice to get up in the morning and look out the window and see frost on the grass. And the house is still toasty warm. It rarely gets under 10 to 12 degrees in our house over winter because we have the heater, the fire going. It's so, what was that about Woolworths? What size pack was the Woolworths pack for $12, Beverly? Okay, I'll go back through my notes because a lot of what we've just covered is in my notes. So I just want to keep up with the comments too. So we're all pretty good shoppers. Like, we are all pretty good shoppers. We know what we need. We know our budgets. We know where to go to get the best deals for us. And if we don't, we ask. We check our prices. We compare unit prices. We look at alternatives if something's just too expensive or we just don't buy it. And I've done that before. If it's been too expensive, that's it. It's off the list. We just don't have it. But there's still things that cause budget blowouts. And often these things are like the spontaneous type purchases. Now they could be well-intentioned purchases, as in you see something that you use all the time on sale. So you, now I've got the hiccups, I'm talking too fast, and you drop a couple in the trolley, even though they're not on your shopping list. That is a huge budget blowout trigger, because we all like a bargain. We all love to save some money. But if it's not on the list, don't get it. If it's not on the list, you need to stop and think about how you are going to pay for it. Now, if you're prepared to be really, really strict and deduct the cost from your next shopping trip, from the budget for your next shopping trip, perfect. Go right ahead. You'll still be on budget. But if you don't do that, if you forget that, and then next week or next month, take out your grocery money, the normal amount, and go and spend it, then you've overspent and you haven't really saved anything. Now, you've paid less because they were on sale, but you've gone over budget, so you haven't really saved a cent. Buying those bargains is great, but you have to remember to account for them in your grocery budget. You have to remember to add them to your inventory and to deduct them from your next lot of grocery money so that you don't go over budget. Now, other triggers, well, they could be the old favorites. Shopping when you're tired. Huge trigger for all of us. You've had a frantic day at work and you just want to get home, but you have to do some shopping first. If that happens, you really need to pay very careful attention to what you put in that trolley. In fact, don't pick up a trolley. And even if it's on the list, check the price. If it's gone up, take a second to see if there's a cheaper alternative. Don't just take it off the shelf and think you're getting the best deal. We really need to be vigilant with this now. It's going to add about 10 minutes to your shopping each week or fortnight or month, but we need to do it. Now, if you're really tired, if you're really stressed, if you're hungry, skip the chocolate aisle, skip the snack aisle, because they are huge budget blowout triggers. Throw in a block of chocolate, even the big $5 ones that have now gone up to $6. That's a lot of money because those things are expensive. And this is where I'm going to talk about the chips. The price of a packet of chips lately. They have almost doubled in price since Christmas. Half price sale now is what the old full price used to be. Now, I checked at Coles before this afternoon, before I popped this price in, $8. $7.60, $8. One was $6.75 for a packet of potato chips. Seriously, guys, I don't care how much money you have. If you are paying $8 for a bag of potato chips, you are stupid, downright stupid. That is just beyond the pale to pay $8 for a bag of potato chips, especially when they are super easy to make in the microwave. If you haven't tried it, do. And you can add your own seasonings to them. Stick to the list. And if, you know, tired, hungry, stressed is a trigger, avoid those aisles. Stick to the list. Another budget blowout is sadly what we think is good for us, fresh fruit and veg. You know, take berries for example. Compare the price of fresh to frozen berries. Now, fresh raspberries, $40 a kilo. Frozen raspberries, $18.83 a kilo. Less than half the price. And frozen fruit is going to last a lot longer than the fresh. Raspberries, I know, bought raspberries from Bushy Park during the summer, and the next day they were moldy. They were a waste. I didn't even get time to make the jam with them, and I let them know too. I was not happy about it. So things like that. I know that frozen mango is cheaper than fresh. And it means you can have it out of season too, because buying in season is a big thing. Frozen fruits and veggies, just as nutritious as fresh, sometimes more nutritious, and they're convenient. They are convenient. This is, you know, when we can embrace convenience when we shop like this. The same applies to veggies. If fresh broccoli is too expensive, or cauliflower is too expensive, or corn is too expensive, check the price of the frozen version. Again, just as nutritious, sometimes even more so because of the way it's processed and the reactions that happen when it's processed. And it's convenient. There's going to be no waste, because that's another thing I want to talk to you about. No waste. Now, they're just simple swaps, fresh for frozen. We can do it. You can do it with all sorts of things. Anyone can do them. And it's paying attention to not only what's on the shopping list, but what you're putting in the trolley. Because you want to stick to the list and you want to know what things are going to blow out your grocery budget. If you haven't budgeted for, you know, $8 worth of raspberries, don't buy them. Find some other fruit. We need to be just a little bit more savvy with our shopping to stay ahead of the game, to stay on budget and still eat well like we like to. Right now, no one can say another thing that's a big expense is meat. No one can say meat's affordable at the moment. It just isn't. Although Costco is still selling mince for $9.99 a kilo. So if you've got a Costco membership, $9.99 a kilo mince is not bad. That's what I canned up earlier this year when I did the 60 jars, 60 pints, was the Costco mince. And it's been great, absolutely great. So I would use that again, happily use that again, especially at that price. Now, again, while I was hunting up for this, I found an article by Meat and Livestock Australia. It was dated 28th of April, so it's a couple of months old. And it actually said that red meat is still very affordable. The average increase of red meat over the last 12 months, 8.2%. And that was below the average food and beverage increase. It was only 1% below. But it was below. They were jumping because it was below. Now I'm pretty sure that I'm paying more than 8.2%. The article does go on to say that in the last quarter of 2022, red meat actually fell in price by 0.28%. And the big winner in the falling meat prices was lamb, and it fell by 2.49%. So lamb has come down a bit in price, or not as a general rule, but I've been able to get legs of lamb. Every now and then they will pop up. Last week, Hannah rang me, said, how much freezer room do you have, Mum? Legs of lamb, $9.99. And I went, oh, probably let me see. I rang her back and said, I've got room for three. So she has three in her freezer for me. Because, you know, $9.99 for a leg of lamb, that's a pretty good price. $12.99 at Coles last week, I noticed. But how does that relate to your grocery budget? Because, you know, saying meat's fallen by, red meat's fallen by 0.28%, really? Do you really notice it? I'm pretty sure I haven't noticed it. It doesn't really, you know, do anything good for my grocery budget. It seems to be actually pushing up the retail price of the meat we're buying. It's not falling. I don't think meat prices are falling, at least not any of the butchers that I visit. Now, lamb has had a drop in price. Like I said, it's sporadic. It's nothing regular. And it's usually just the legs of lamb. So your chops, things like that, back straps and stuff aren't. Even the sides of lamb haven't come down in price. Now, you can let me know in the comments if you're finding that prices are coming down, but I'm not. I'm really not. Which begs me to ask, how do we eat red meat and stick to our grocery budget? Well, we've sort of lucked out for the moment because it's winter. So that really helps, because in winter we eat more stews, more casseroles, braisers, pies, that sort of thing. And they're good because they use cheaper cuts of meat. And those cheaper cuts of meat, they're really good for that sort of thing because they hold up well with the long, slow cooking. They might be fork tender, but they don't fall apart. So things like your chuck steak or your casserole steak, oyster blade, they're all good for winter meals, really good for winter meals. And mince can still be good value, especially because you can stretch it easily. With very, very little change to the finished meal. If you're smart, you know, TVP, or you've got lentils, you can add rice, you can add oats, you can add grated veggies, all sorts of things to mince to stretch it. And that it makes it sort of good value. The other cheap meat, the one we Aussies just love, is chicken. Love, love our chicken. Now, chicken is still cheaper per kilo than red meat on a sort of, kilo for kilo basis. But it's gone up in price. And you can still get the cost per meal down if you try. Now, it's been suggested to use chicken mince instead of chicken fillets for different things. I don't like chicken mince. I loathe chicken mince. But anyway, so I don't buy it. But that's another option if you do. The other thing is to buy whole chickens. Frozen are cheaper per kilo than fresh, and cut them up yourself. Now, I've got a whole on the website somewhere, a whole thing step by step on how to cut up a chicken. It's not that difficult. If I can do it, anyone can do it. So it's not that difficult to do. And often you'll find whole chickens, fresh ones will come down to $2.99 a kilo, $3.99 a kilo on sale. That's not a bad price. That's not a bad price. And a whole chicken is very versatile. You can get a lot of meals out of a whole chicken. And that brings me to portion control. We need to remember our portion control with everything we eat, but especially with the expensive stuff like the meat, the chicken, the seafood, because that not only affects the cost and so it hits your grocery budget, but it can affect our health too. So we need to remember portion control. Now I'm going to zip back just for a second. Oh, Caitlin, see, no, I just can't do chicken mince. Cauliflowers on Sunday, cauliflowers were $2 each, so I picked some up. I have cauliflowers growing in the garden, but I'll just leave them there. I can get them for $2. And broccoli was $2 a kilo. Celery was $1 a bunch, so I've got one bunch left to go through the dryer, dehydrator, the dryer, the dehydrator. Carrots were $1 a kilo, but my best bargain was the onions, 80 cents a kilo. So I've got some put aside to do caramelized onions, and the rest have been chopped or sliced, bagged up and frozen. I've kept a half a dozen to put through the dehydrator because I've got a lot of dried onion anyway, and if I need to, I can get some out of the freezer and dehydrate it. Wow, Melissa, frozen potato gems, $6.50. I've never been able to make them. Okay, no. Kilo packets of mince. Thank you. That was, I asked, kilo. All right. Sorry, guys. I'm trying to keep up. Your comments are coming in faster than I can keep up with them. Thought someone just came in the door. I've been making chips for. I used to always just buy generic frozen chips or generic frozen wedges. And then they went up in price. And I could get potatoes for 50 cents a kilo. Why would I pay $3 for 750 grams of chips or wedges when I could do a kilo for, by the time I'd scrubbed them, probably didn't quite weigh a kilo. So much better and so much easier to do. They taste better. I do them, I put smoky paprika on them and they are delicious. Absolutely delicious. So things like your broccoli, your cauliflower, they're in season at the moment. So they should be cheaper. Should be, being the operative words, because just because they are in season doesn't necessarily mean that they are going to be cheaper, but they should be. 98 cents for cauliflower, that's great. You could have cauliflower soup, you could have crumb cauliflower, you could have cauliflower cheese, you could have roasted cauliflower. Oh my goodness. Jane says, hi Jane, you go for Queenslanders. Queensland, fresh and safe, have lamb for $9 a kilo. Great price. Great, great price. Hi, Maddie. Must be chilly out your way. It's chilly here, so it must be chilly out your way. I haven't needed to buy beans, Tegan. I did a big bean stock up. I did two big bean stock ups last year. So I've got enough beans for a while. So I haven't needed to buy them. So I haven't even looked at the price of beans. Hello, Kathy. I've got, you love your berries, Delaney. I've got raspberries. I've got black currants. We've got our strawberries that just keep spreading and spreading and spreading. So do the raspberries. I have one blueberry. I don't think it will do much. I might need to get some more blueberries. But they are just prolific. They have just been so good with berries feeding us. Karen got boneless pork roast for $6 a kilo. Maura, yeah, I'm sorry. Chicken mince, ugh. When I want shredded chicken, I poach the chicken fillet, whatever, or usually, because I just buy chicken fillets, so I just poach them, and then I just shred them with my hand mixer. Tear it in half or cut it in quarters and just shred it with my hand mixer, and it's done in like 10 seconds. It's so convenient, and it goes so much further. So if I'm doing enchiladas, or if I'm doing chicken salad, that's how I do the chicken. It's really, really good. There you go. So $16.99. So $1.70 a burger. That's pretty good. Pretty good, Yvonne. That's not bad at all. Mary wants to know where you got your cheap veg from, folks. Okay. Beverly, you've never frozen onion? Seriously? Oh, my goodness. So. When you've got a lot of onions, these days they just don't seem to keep like they used to. Not the bought ones anyway. So, yeah, chop them, dice them, grate them, slice them, bag them up. I usually bag them in sliced onions. I sort of do a handful into a bag. But if they're grated or diced, it's either a quarter or a half a cup. And I do both because it depends on what I'm making, how much I will use. Pop them in the freezer. Easy peasy. Easy peasy. And then they last for ages. And take it out of the freezer, open the zippy bag, drop it into the pan or pot or whatever I'm making, and it's done. Really, really easy. Now, the zippy bags hold the onion smell. So I write on them with Sharpie that they're onion. I wash them and they go into their own box in the drawer. So they are the onion bags, just so I don't put, you know, bread roll in it and it gets the onion smell. But yeah, no, really, 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 really easy. Wow, $10 a kilo for lamb chops. Wonder what they're like. Freezing onions, so, so easy. One of my favorite things to do is you don't have to blanch them. I'm not the queen of blanching. It's not me. If I get the little pickling onions, I will freeze them whole so that then they just become roast onions when we have a roast. Okay, now let's get going because we're going to run out of time. We can make all the substitutes we like. It's really good to do that. And our grocery budget won't blow out. But something else to consider is we can put a lot of effort into making those substitutes, finding cheaper products, alternatives, and so on. But that effort is wasted if we waste what we buy, if we waste the groceries. So make sure you use everything, everything you buy, all of it. Now, that statement means that composting doesn't count. If you have food that you need to compost, you're wasting it. Even potato peels can be turned into what we call them hot lips. My kids love them. When I peel potatoes, I will give them a good scrub and then slightly thicker peel, not the really skinny one, just a slightly thicker peel so there's a little bit of potato on them. Fry them up, salt them, eat them. You can have them. They're really good with sour cream and sweet chili sauce as dip. My kids, we call them hot lips. Mum used to make it for us. I've made them for our kids all their lives, and we just call them hot lips. So even the potato peels can be used for something. Carrot peels, onion skins, any veggie peel can be turned into veggie stock. Don't throw it out until you've turned it into stock. Then the peel can be composted if you don't have chooks to feed them to, or if you don't want to put them into dog food. If you've got a dog and you're making dog food, you can add them to the dog food. But not the onions. Don't give the dog onions. But don't compost food until it absolutely used it all. Now, I bought watermelon for our fresh fruit this week. It was $1 a kilo. I wish I'd bought more. I bought a whole one. I wish I'd bought two or three. It is the sweetest watermelon we have had in years. It was so, so good. I even got up in the middle of the night, Sunday night, got up in the middle of the night for a drink and thought, gonna have a piece of watermelon. So there I was standing over the sink at 3 o'clock in the morning having a piece of watermelon. It was delicious. It is just good. But I'm saving the rind because the rind can be used. You can make I was skeptical. I did not think it was going to work, but you can make a really nice pie, sweet pie, dessert pie with watermelon rind. Sounds absurd. And everyone has always said, don't eat the rind. You'll get a tummy ache if you eat the rind. You can't eat the rind. Yes, you can. The, the recipe's in the recipe file. But it is so, so good. So don't just automatically throw those things out. If you don't know what to do with it, look, do some research, find out, look for a recipe, type in, you know, recipes for watermelon rind or recipes for whatever, and see what you can come up with. I'm pretty sure, because we had it, I'm pretty sure we all remember the great broccoli stalk controversy of 2022. It was rather heated. And, you know, what to do with broccoli stalks and how to use them and whether we should pay for them or not. Use them, guys. Use the broccoli stalks. I don't break them off. I just put the heads in the steamer, stalk and all, and we eat them. But if you're a little fussy and you don't like the stalk, grate it. Try it grated and then add it to a pasta sauce or to a soup or to a casserole. I love it in coleslaw. If I'm making coleslaw and I've got broccoli, I might chop the stalk off and add some broccoli stalk to the coleslaw. Just don't waste it. Just don't think that you can't use it, that it has to be composted or given to the chickens or whatever. That's just money you've spent for nothing. Now, right now it's citrus season, so we've got oranges, we've got mandarins, we've got grapefruit, we've got lemons, and they're all reasonably cheap. I think I paid $5 for 6 kilos of oranges last week. Not many left because they were really nice oranges. So everyone's been eating oranges. That's been our fresh fruit. But use the peel. Now, we all know how to make the citrus cleaner. Put the peels in the jar, top it up with vinegar, let it sit for a while. Then you've got your citrus cleaner. Dehydrate them. Slice it into thin slices. Dehydrate it. And then dip it in chocolate and eat them. Or make a sugar syrup, slice the peels very thinly, make a sugar syrup, so it's usually 1 cup of sugar to 1 cup of water, simple syrup. Pop the orange or lemon or grapefruit peel, whatever you've got, into the sugar syrup. Let them cook for a few minutes, drain them out, put them on some silicone paper to cool, and then dip them in chocolate and eat them. Yum. Really, really nice. So, so good. They're delicious. Just don't waste it. Just don't think, oh, you've got to eat it. Apple peels can be dehydrated and powdered and used to flavor things. They can be same deal as with the potato peels. You can make them into chips. You can boil them up with some sugar syrup, a little bit of water, and make a cordial from them. Don't throw out the apple peels. If you're going to make the cordial, toss in the cores too. You can dry the citrus peels and use them as violators. Just make sure that you're using all of what you're buying, all of what you pay for, and that you're not wasting a cent. You want to get your money's worth. You want to get what you've paid for. So use it all. If you've got sad fruit, we all know to turn sad fruit into a pie or a crumble or a sponge pudding or into jam or marmalade. You can whiz it up with a little bit of fruit juice and dehydrate it to make fruit leathers. There's all sorts of things you can do. You don't need to throw it out. Same deal with the sad veggies. Add them to soup or turn them into a relish or a pickle. Dehydrate them and powder them to use in moo cup soups and to add to stocks to make a soup. So many things you can do with them. Just make sure you use it all. Otherwise, it's wasted money and we can't afford to waste that money. I don't want to have to increase my grocery budget by $36 or $37 a week. I don't want to have to do that. the last thing I want to point out is when you're shopping, stick to your list. Now, I say it all the time. If it's not on the list, don't buy it. Stick to your list. But keep an eye on the fruits and the veggies and the meat that blows out your budget. Always, always look for a cheaper substitute so that you can stay on budget, because that's your goal, to stay on budget, to get what you need on budget. And, okay, so that reminds me, I'll remind you, don't be brand loyal. Now, there's only two things I'm brand loyal about, tea and coffee. And I wait until the brands that I like are on half price sale, and then I will stock up. Otherwise, if I'm shopping, price has gone up, I will switch brands in a heartbeat if there is one cheaper that does the same job. My days of being brand loyal are over. I'm not getting any loyalty back. I'm not getting any loyalty back from supermarkets. I'm not getting any loyalty back from the manufacturers. My days of being brand loyal are long gone. So don't be brand loyal. And when you're making up your shopping list, I gotta keep going. I told you, you're making up your shopping list, make sure you're not doubling up. So that means replace what you use from your stockpile. That's sensible. Just be savvy about it. If it's stuff that's not really important or you only use occasionally, perhaps you can skip it and find a substitute with something you've already got. Be a bit savvy about it. Use your meal plan to make sure that you're getting what you need and only what you need, so that there are no budget blowouts. I know that sticking to the grocery budgets is getting harder and harder and harder and harder and more frustrating, but we can still do it. We just need to put the effort in. And really, it isn't any harder than what most of us do right now. We put a bit of effort in to write our shopping list, to have our meal plan, to know what we're doing. If we keep doing that, we should be able to stay on budget and keep our grocery bill low, because we now know what those budget blowouts are going to be, and we're aware of them. And when we're aware of them, we can prepare for them. Okay, now let's sit back over here. Oh, dehydrated apple peels are really nice to just nibble on too, Estelle. You will really like them. Really, really like them. There we go. Tegan says home brand diced veggies contain diced broccoli stalks. Karen, my kids preferred raw veggies, any raw veggies, over cooked veggies for years and years and years. Absolutely. Good price for pears, $2.97 a kilo. That's not too bad. My poor pear trees lost all their leaves. They look a bit sad at the moment, but I'm hoping that we'll get lots of pears this year. Okay. Choco is really good. Choco is one of those vegetables that doesn't really have a flavor. It's very bland. So it goes really well with all sorts of things. You can do half choco and half apple in an apple pie. You stew it up with the apples to make an apple pie or an apple crumble or an apple sponge. Works really, really good. I love choco. I love it roasted with curry sauce. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Jackos are really versatile. I've tried to grow them here and I don't have much luck with them, but anyway. So now, we're not too late. Thank goodness for that. News on the news front. I'm going away. I will be away for 4 weeks. I won't be back till the end of July. Wayne is frantically trying to work out internet for me, so that we can still do our Tuesday nights, and he'll work it out. He's got, I don't know, we looked at Starlink, but it's so expensive. Honestly, we live in a first world country, and you move off the eastern seaboard or around the coast, and you simply cannot get internet. It is beyond ridiculous. Even going from Melbourne to Sydney, I still had dead spots on my phone and couldn't use my phone. Just ridiculous. Absolutely, it's appalling. Absolutely appalling. Anyway, I'm whinging about it because it's affecting me. I'll be away for 4 weeks. So, but there are videos coming up. There will be more videos to keep you enthralled while I'm away. Newsletter will still go out every week. I've got that all set and organized. We've worked out how to do that. We will be doing some really remote traveling this time. So we've looked into, we've boosted our solar setup on our camper. And I've increased the amount of food we're taking with us and the water, simply because we will be away for quite a while and we will be very, very, very remote. So there will be videos, there will be YouTubes and so on, and there'll still be Tuesday nights. And I'll try, if I can get whatever it is to work and connect, I'll pop on too. Otherwise, I'm away for 4 weeks. Now, if you need to contact me, the contact us form on our website, the link is below me. That is the way to do it. That is the way to do it. I get those. I don't get anything else. Anything else is just filtered off and goes to the great unknown. Contact us, always works really, really well. Rachel, that's really nice. Well, we're sort of working, but we'll have a good time. And hopefully, I was looking at the weather and thinking, it's going to be warm. No, it's not. It's cold. I wasn't really happy. It's going to be dry. No, it's not. It's wet. So I'm not really sure. Remote for the next 2 weeks. You see a big orange caravan. Okay, we will. Well, if you see a white tea van with a blue stripe, that'll be us. Just give us a wave. So we'll be having lots of fun. Hannah's coming with us, which will be fun. This is the first time she's come on a remote trip with us, so that will be really good. Otherwise, everything will just roll along. But just so you know, yeah, I'll be away. So I'll do my best to stay in touch. And I will be back. Hopefully, I'll be back soon. Okay, now, if you've stuck with me this long, thank you. I really appreciate it. If you're watching this on the replay, some people will watch on the replay, if you could do me a favor and leave a comment underneath, it helps me with planning future videos. And I've already picked up a couple of ideas from last week, so that's really good. I'll work on those. Hopefully while I'm away, I'll get a bit of downtime. I read all your comments. I will go back and read all the comments, and I do my best to answer your questions. Just, you know, sometimes if my answer isn't what you wanted, I've still answered. Anyway, please remember to give us a thumbs up, like. If you're not already subscribed to our channel, hit the subscribe button and the little bell. And if you know someone who might like this video or who might like to know more about cheapskates, click the share link. these two things, they really help our channel grow, and they make it easier to find, because there are billions of channels on YouTube. And the easier it is to find us, the easier it is for us to spread the message that it's not only okay to live life debt-free, cashed up and laughing, but right now in 2023, it is absolutely still doable, because we are doing it. Okay, even in these crazy, crazy times, we can do it. All right, have a great week, everyone. Happy cheap skating, and I'll be back live when I get home. See you later.